Hi everybody, and welcome to this, my second of three videos on the Pentax 645N2. This is a pretty spectacular camera. In the first video we talked about what all the buttons are. Now let's talk about what all they do and how to use them. We're going to go through the camera. I'm going to show you how to do basically everything you need to know with it, and we're going to start by loading film. So here's the back of the camera, and you load the film here. Turn it from locked to unlocked. It's unlocked now when the two dots are lined up. To release it, you turn the dot until it hits the end of that line and then lift. And there we go. To load the film, you take the old spool out of the, this is where the new film is going to go. So you take the old spool out of that and put it over here. If you don't have an old spool, you're going to have to pick one up either from a friend or on eBay for 20 cents, whatever they are. You know, they're not impossible to get. So then you put the old spool over here, and you want to make sure that the take-up slot is lined up vertically. If it's not, if it's like this, you just have to rotate this gear until it's lined up. Now, loading the film, you're going to take the tape or paper off of it. This is a little bit tricky because it's easy to put it in the wrong way because it's a little bit counterintuitive. But what you want to do is pull it out so that the printed end is hidden when you start to pull out the leader. This camera does not like metal spools. Now you're going to pull this out until the start line, there we go, appears, and these arrows, they're different with every type of maker, but you always have two arrows or triangles line up with the orange dot, orange index right there. Pull out the leader, bring it over here. You're going to feed it into the take-up spool and just turn it. This only turns one way, so you can't turn it the wrong way. If you can, you're a better man than I am. So turn it until you've taken up all the slack. And there we go. Set it in. Turn this again. In order to place it into the camera's body, you've got to turn this again to drop it down there. Lock. There we go. Now, we're not done yet. We have a couple other things we got to do. Got to turn it on. Now we're going to set the ISO. And to set the ISO, you turn this dial to ISO. And now you set it to whatever you're going to shoot. If you're shooting the same film, you don't have to do this. If you're going to change film, you have to change this every single time. And the only way to do it is through this ISO setting. 120 doesn't have DX codes like 35 millimeter does, so there's no automatic ISO setting on this. So let's say you're using 200 ISO. There we go. ISO is set. Now, we can't take pictures yet because it hasn't wound the leader onto the take-up spool. Now it's wound the leader onto the take-up spool, and you can see we're about to take the first frame. So let's see what that looks like. I've got the camera set to 4 seconds. So what happens is the mirror pops up, the shutter opens, the film's exposed to light, shutter closes, mirror folds down. When the lens is on, the lens focuses the light onto the film plane and stops down the aperture for your depth of field. This camera also has, so there's different shooting modes, single frame. You push it once, it'll take a picture. You can hold it down as long as you want. It's not going to take any more. We'll come back to this one, which is continuous shooting. But as long as you hold it down, it's going to take pictures. Self-timer. Self-timer you can set, and we'll see in the third video how to set the time on it. But you can set it for 12 seconds or 2 seconds. It counts down, and then after the self-timer is finished, it takes the picture. And then mirror lockup. A lot of people in reviews I've seen on this camera seem not to understand how this works or that the camera even has an MLU button. So I'm going to show you how to do this. The first time you push it, it locks up the mirror. Second time, it takes the picture. So let's see what that looks like without the lens. Push it once, mirror locks up, but you can see the shutter curtain's still closed and it's not going to take the picture until you push it again. So in terms of technique of using mirror lockup on this camera, a really good way to do it is to have a cable shutter release. So you push the cable shutter release and let go, that locks up the mirror. Then, if you're, let's say, in bulb mode, you push the cable shutter release again, it starts the exposure, you tighten the lock on it, come back whenever you're done. If you're taking a 4 second or a 60th of a second exposure with mirror lockup, you hit it once and then hit it a second time, and then it will take a picture as though you'd actually pushed that. So here we are in multiple, in continuous drive mode. And I'm gonna finish off the film this way. It'll count up to 16. With 120, you can take either 16 or 15 exposures, and we'll see how to change that setting in the PF in the third video in the series. But as you can hear, this is not a stealthy camera. This is not something you want to use to surreptitiously take pictures of people on the street. It's loud. So now when you're done, it says end up here. So let's see what this looks like on the inside. Turn it 90 degrees to unlock. Twist it to release. There we go. And you can see the film's been taken up onto the new spool. Now, if this was real film and not just empty backing paper, you'd fold this over and seal it and send it off to be developed or develop it yourself. Then you take the empty spool that you just used, move it over here. There we go. Line it up properly. There. Oh, come on. How do I keep missing this? There we go. Now, I'm gonna grab the new film. Pretend this is new film. Pretend it doesn't say exposed on it. This film is on backwards, but you just line it up with the arrows again when you load your new one. And then we're good to go. So all the power that this uses, the motor drive, auto exposure, everything, it requires a pretty big power source. And so it's got 9 volts of power in it. In the handle here, here are the batteries. It's 6 AA batteries. And to change them, all you have to do is, when you take them out after they're dead, you just replace them, and they go, this is the bottom of the grip right here, plus down, plus up. And then they just get reinserted. There you go. That's the batteries. The flash hot shoe is right here, and you can either plug a flash into here or you can use the PC port. Flash sync on this camera is 1/60th of a second, which is honestly kind of slow, but it is also a medium format camera. So going much faster than 1/60th of a second is hard, if not impossible. Now, what do I mean when I say the flash sync is 1/60th of a second? So let's say that this is a scene you're gonna take a picture of, okay? My hands are going to represent the shutter curtain. So here's the shutter curtain, and it's blocking all the light from the film. Well, you take a picture, it opens up, and then here comes this other shutter curtain. You finish the picture, and then it resets, okay? So let's say you're taking a picture at 1/30th of a second. It's going to open up, expose the whole scene, and then this one's going to come through. Let's say you're at 1/60th of a second. It's going to open up, and then as this is open, you're gonna have a very brief moment where the whole scene is exposed to light, and then the second curtain's gonna come through. But what if you're taking a picture at 1/1000th of a second? First one's gonna open, and then the second one's gonna come right behind it with a very thin little gap between the two curtains. So it's not that the curtains physically move faster when you have an exposure that's faster. There's just a narrow gap, and it for 1/25th it might be something like this, and for 1/500th it might be something like that. But you're not moving the curtains faster, you're just increasing or decreasing the size of the gap. So at 1/60th of a second, the gap is the full size of the film. So the first curtain opens, flash, exposes your whole image, the light comes back, and then the second curtain. So anything from 1/60th of a second and slower, you can use a flash and get a proper flash exposure with it. In a studio setting at night, it doesn't matter what your flash sync speed is. It really doesn't. Where it matters, and having it go to 1/25th, 2/50th, or 1/300th on a few cameras, is when you're using a flash during daylight hours. So this camera has a good size image. It uses what's called the 645 format. If you're comfortable with 35mm, you're going to like 645. When you use the camera and you look through the viewfinder, your viewfinder image is going to be 76% of the size that it will be on the film, which is still gives you using the viewfinder on this camera is amazing. It's got a great viewfinder. Even at 0.76, the image is still significantly larger than a 35mm negative. It's really wonderful. The viewfinder on this camera is great. The only downside is it's got a 92% frame coverage, which leaves you some interesting cropping or some interesting framing issues when you get your negatives back. That's not the end of the world, but there are people who complain that it's not 100% coverage. I'm kind of in this camp. The focusing screen, when you look through the viewfinder, let's take a look through the viewfinder right now and see what that looks like. So here we are looking through the viewfinder of the 645N. You can see here the brackets. The center bracket, the center dot is your spot meter indicator. Then the outside bracket, and it also indicates your center focusing point. Your outside brackets indicate the range of the multiple focusing points. So there you can see the viewfinder information. There we go. Over that's on the left side is your exposure information. Right. Come on, there we go. There's the exposure information. Shutter speed, aperture, and that's all that's in the viewfinder in terms of data. So I've taken off the eye cup. I'm going to show you how to put it on. Here's the viewfinder, and to put the eye cup on, slide it on the back here. Okay, now that it's on the back, you want to line it up. There we go. And it clicks into place. There's a couple of notches that hold it into place. Just going to take a quarter. On this body, at least, a quarter does not contact the viewfinder eyepiece as you tighten the retaining ring that holds it in place. A penny, a dime, nickels, those do. So if you have a quarter, that's ideal. Now once it's tightened, there we go, it's in place. So the next thing we're going to do is I'm going to show you how to change the focusing screen. All right, so with the lens off, you can see up in there, there's a little clip right here where my finger is. Now you don't really want to use your finger for this because you risk touching the mirror, but I don't have the proper tool and I know how to do this with my finger. So what you want to do is hold it like this, and with the proper tool, there's a little tab here, you pull it toward you. When you pull it toward you, the viewfinder display hold, the viewfinder caddy pops out. The tool that you use to change the viewfinder focusing screen comes with a tweezers. But since I don't have a tweezers, we're just going to use standard tweezers. We're going to go into the viewfinder. So in here you can see the viewfinder. And what happens when you pull the tab toward you with the tweezers or the proper tool, this little black caddy here pops down. That caddy holds the focusing screen. You put the tweezers from the focusing screen changing set underneath this little tab, pinch, and pull. There we go. Now you've got your focusing screen. Now the nice thing about a removable focusing screen, sure you can put in the others, of which there are six different kinds, but you can also clean dust off of it really easy and dust off the underside of the prism without having to send it into a shop. And that's really nice and a good thing about professional grade cameras. Now you've cleaned it or you've swapped out the prism. So now once you remove the prism, now to put it back, or once you remove the focusing screen, to put it back in, you're going to take the tweezers that come with it, preferably not actual tweezers like I have to use today. You're going to hold the new focusing screen or the newly cleaned one by the tab. Only hold it by the tab. These are plastic. If you put the tweezers anywhere on the mat, you will ruin your screen. Now slowly, carefully lower it back into place. There's that tab goes into a little indent right there, and if once it's there, you know that it's seated properly. Now to close this, you lower it back into the horizontal position. And actually, in a perfect world, this whole procedure should be done with the camera horizontal like this. And there we go. It's back in place. the whole thing functions. It requires gravity to do that completely properly and most easily. So I had it tilted on its back for display, but if you do it, try to keep the camera with the base on whatever surface you're working on. Okay, so let's talk about what some of these other things do. And after we've talked about all of this, we'll go through how to take a picture with the camera. So over here, we have your metering modes. Green is matrix, center weighted, and spot. So what matrix does is matrix has divided the scene into a bunch of pre-made shapes. And what the meter does in this mode is that it takes the light coming from each of the different zones, and then it calculates the proper exposure. It knows what's sky, what's super bright, what's shadow, or at least has a good idea of it, and then from that builds the best shutter speed and aperture combination for you. So if it says you're at 1/125th and f5.6, you can also say 1/60th and f8, or 1/250th and f4.5. Those will all give you roughly the same exposure with different depths of field and different shutter times. Center weighted, what that does is center weighted still looks at the entire scene, but it takes the center part of the data. So let's say you have something very large and dark in the center of your image. It's going to give the majority of the exposure information of the exposure weight to that central thing. Now, the way that a light meter works is basically it sees the world as a flat gray. So pretend that the sun wasn't casting this bright area, but this whole thing was the same tone of gray. That's what the light meter thinks your world looks like. It's the easiest way to think about it. So matrix thinks that everything, it tries to balance out all of the metering so it's flat gray. The center weighted says, well, this right, what's here in the middle, 70, I'm gonna count that 75% as flat gray. So if you have a very dark object or a very light object in the middle of your scene, a dark object will give you a longer exposure period because it's trying to make the black flat gray. Whereas if you have a light bulb, it will give you a very fast exposure because it's trying to make the light bulb flat gray. But it still looks at all of the data. So if you have a dark object here and then light or gray around it, the light and the gray around it are still going to contribute to the exposure. That's different from spot metering, where 100% of the exposure comes from the center of the image. So if you have something black here in the center, it doesn't matter what's around it. You could have a dozen arc lights around it, and it only cares about this black spot in the center in terms of calculating the exposure. So likewise, let's say you have something gray or green or blue, whatever, for your spot meter, that's what it's going to count. So how do we use these? Well, if you're just out doing some general shooting, matrix metering is just fine. It's going to give you really good exposures. This has a pretty advanced meter in it. Center weighted is another way to do it. If you're doing let's say portraits or something, you've got somebody's face filling up most of the frame, and you're going to put their face in the center, going with center weighted will make it so that their face is properly exposed. If they're in front of a black background, it'll look very dark. If they're in front of a white background, it will look very light. Now, let's say you're using spot metering. Spot metering is good if you want to have a specific thing be properly exposed. So let's say you've got this gray area over here, and you want it to be this gray so that this camera looks this black and this light area looks super light. You take a meter reading off of this with your spot meter, set your settings, recompose, and take your picture. Spot meter is a very strong tool if you're not using auto exposure mode. You can use auto exposure with spot metering, but you can get the most out of it if you use spot metering to collect a reading and use that to assume that what you're reading is your middle gray, and that's going to make all of the darks look suitably dark and all of the lights look suitably light. You can also use spot metering to take multiple readings, 1/125th at f5.6, 1/8th at f5.6, 1/1000th at f5.6, let's say. So now you know that you have multiple bright and dark spots. From that, you can then come up with your own estimation of what you want the exposure to be. Well, if I make this 1/250th, this will be a dark shadow here. This will be really black. And then this will be slightly darker than bright white. So you can take multiple spot readings off your scene and come up with an idea of a crafted exposure that you want to take. So spot metering is actually the most powerful form of metering if you practice with it and really know how to use it very well. If you're just using spot metering because it's easy, there might be better options like center weighted. Over here we have auto bracketing. Now when you look through the viewfinder, if you use auto bracketing, you'll see an indicator flashing in the viewfinder that you're using auto bracketing. There'll be individual dots above the viewfinder exposure bar, and they'll flash letting you know which exposure you're about to take: underexposed, properly exposed, or overexposed. And you can change the settings for that in the PF, which is in the third video in this series. So the further that you rotate the dial this way, the greater the distance between your exposure brackets. So I believe it's something like, this is nothing, there's just going to be one exposure. Now you're going to have three or five, depending on your settings. They're going to be like a third of a step apart, two thirds of a step, a full step. So what bracketing does is, let's say you have a brightly contrasty scene like this one, dark, gray, light. If your camera's telling you that your proper exposure is 1/125th at f5.6, and you bracket, then you're going to get one that's 1/125th at f5.6, one that's at 1/60th, and one that's 1/250th. And so it will give you different exposures, so that, because sometimes a scene with a lot of contrast can trick a camera's meter. And so bracketing your exposures gives you a better chance of having one of the shots turn out the way you want it to turn out. And yeah, you end up with two or four shots that don't turn out that way, but hey, sometimes those also have pretty interesting results and can deliver some really nifty images. The next thing that we need to talk about is that this camera is a multi-mode camera. It shoots in program, aperture priority, shutter priority, and full manual. So let's take a look at how to get to each of those modes. First thing I'm going to do is show you how to shoot in program mode, which is program mode really is not the best solution because the camera decides everything for you and it takes all the control out of your hands. So program mode is okay if you're learning how to use a camera, but it's not ideal for shooting all the time. To get to program mode in this camera, you set your shutter speed dial to A and you set your aperture dial to A. Automatic aperture, automatic shutter speed, camera's going to decide everything and take the picture for you when you push the button. So what about shutter priority? Shutter priority is good if you want to have a fixed shutter speed but don't care about your aperture. So let's say you're at a sporting event and your kid's coming around, it's track and field, he's about to take first place, you want to have a thousandth of a second because you want to capture your kid's motion as he's coming through the line at the end of the race. So you set this to 1/1000th and leave this in A. The camera's going to fire at 1/1000th of a second and pick the best aperture for that shutter speed. Now let's say you want to shoot in aperture priority mode. Aperture priority mode means that you pick the aperture or the depth of field. Typically in aperture priority mode, we're shooting to control the depth of field to create a specific image and not have to worry about the shutter exposure. So what you do is you just pick your aperture, make sure that's an A, and take your picture. And your camera's going to know, okay, I'm an f5.6 or 6.3, whatever I'm set on right here, and I'm an A, so at that exposure I need a 1/212th of a second. It's a stepless shutter speed when you shoot in automatic mode. It will pick whatever shutter speed is required, even if it's one that's between these individual marked shutter speeds, to give you the best exposure. Same thing when you're shooting in shutter priority mode with the aperture. If you have an aperture that should be f9.687, it will give you that aperture. It doesn't have to be one of the marked or indented apertures. So those are program shutter priority and aperture priority. Full manual mode means going and setting the shutter speed yourself and shutting the aperture yourself. You can read the light meter on the inside when you're in full manual mode and watch. There's a little dot above, there's a bar on the bottom and there's a little dot that'll move above it. And that will tell you how over or underexposed you are. And what will happen is if you're overexposed, it'll be a bar going to the right. And if you're underexposed, it's a bar going to the left. And your goal is to adjust the aperture and or the aperture and shutter speed so that the bar is in the middle of that range, of that exposure range. Now, manual is really useful if you want to control your exposure precisely in terms of what you want it to be. So let's say you're at a cafe and you're sitting in under an awning, and then behind you is this awesome mountain in full sun. If you just set an aperture priority, shutter priority, or program mode, you're going to get a great image of that mountain with a really dark image of whomever you actually want to take the picture of who's sitting under the awning. So what you can do is go into spot metering mode, take a meter reading off the face of the person who's in the shade, and then take a meter reading off the mountain. Then you know that the person in the shade needs a 1/60th at f5.6, and then the mountain needs 1/500th at f5.6. So if you compromise at 1/125th, you're gonna end up with a slightly shaded person and a fairly bright but still visible mountain. And you can correct that in post, or the printer can correct that when they make your print. You could also bracket or things like that, but manual allows you to go into the actual shutter speed and aperture, take control of them, and tell the camera exactly what you want it to do. It's a very powerful tool. So now that we've seen all that, let's talk about how to take a picture with this camera. Let's take off the lens cap so we can take an actual picture. Well, not really, there's no film in it, but play along. So the first thing you need to do is figure out which mode you're going to shoot in: program, shutter priority, aperture priority, or full manual. Let's shoot in full manual for this. So take your meter reading, you're going to adjust your shutter speed and your aperture to get that line right in the middle on the exposure scale. And we know that we're at 1/125th and f/16. Okay, fantastic. So you can either focus, or most if not all of the 645 lenses, the newer ones at any rate, have autofocus. Come on, really? There we go. So if you have to press the shutter button, you can autofocus. And I'm sitting too close to it, so it's not going to be able to focus on me, so I'll just leave it in manual focus because I can trick it to take a picture. And then when you have your image in focus, composed, everything set the way you want it, there we go. You've taken a picture. Now, let's say that your kid's coming around and you've got it set to 1/1000th of a second and you're in shutter priority mode now and he's coming into the finish line, but you don't want to risk missing him actually coming through and breaking the thingy that crosses the finish line. You want to go into continuous drive and shoot off a bunch as he's about to cross the finish line and get the best picture you can. What about double exposures? Double exposures are an interesting thing to try, right? I mean, sure. So on the side here, we've got the double exposure button. Here's the double exposure button. Now you can see there's a little dial, and it goes up, when you turn it enough, it goes up to, there's a symbol here that looks like two frames overlapping. So we're gonna turn it until it clicks into place. It's gonna stay in place. And this orange dot lets you know you're in double exposure mode. So whenever you take multiple exposures, you're giving the film more light, right? So let's say that you have, your meter reading tells you 1/125th at f5.6, right? Here we are. And that's good for a single exposure. Your camera does not know, even though you've put multiple exposure mode on, that you're going to take multiple exposures. So what you have to do is compensate. A couple ways to do that. You need to have half as much light if you're going to take a double exposure. So you can go to f8 and take the picture. You can go to 1/250th and take a picture. If you adjust this, you're going to adjust the depth of field. So it's better to adjust the shutter speed, which you can very easily do by going to -1. That's one stop less light than 1/125th at f5.6. So this is the same as changing the shutter speed dial to 1/250th. So there are a couple different ways to do this. What you want to do then is take your first picture And you can hear that it didn't advance the film. There was no motor winding sound. So you've taken the first half of your double exposure. Now you recompose or go wherever, right? And you want to take your second shot. Turn off the double exposure if this is the last of them. Take the second shot. You can hear it takes a picture and then advances the film. For double exposures, I think it's better to use the exposure compensation dial. And the reason is, what you can do is then you can set it into shutter priority or aperture priority mode, or even program mode, and do double exposures. Because what will happen is the camera knows that you're supposed to be at 1/125th and f/5/6. Okay, but I need one stop less light, so it's going to be 1/250th. Or 1/125th and f/8. Depends on what the camera wants to do. It depends on how you also have it set. In aperture priority mode, the camera will adjust the shutter speed to arrive at that. In shutter priority mode, it will adjust the aperture to arrive at one stop less light. In program mode, who knows? It's going to do whatever it wants because that's what program mode is. But what about a triple exposure? Can either go negative two stops. And the problem with negative two stops is you start to get into things like reciprocity failure or risking it in some situations. So for a triple exposure, it's good to go down to negative 1 2/3 stops or 1.5 stops if you have your camera set that way. We'll see how to do that in the third video. I'm going to go back here, set it back into double exposure or multiple exposure mode. Taking three shots, I have screwed up though. I just took my third shot and it's still in the double exposure mode. It hasn't advanced the film. That's okay. Put the lens cap on, set it to f/22, 1/1000th of a second. Turn off your multiple exposure mode. In almost every setting, this is so little light that it's not going to mess up your exposure, especially with the lens cap on. So that's what happens if you accidentally forget to turn it off of double exposure, multiple exposure mode after your last shot. And that is it for this in the second video. If this video was helpful, please give me a thumbs up. That lets me know I'm on the right track and that I'm making content which is useful to you. If you have questions or comments, please leave those below. I'm pretty good about responding quickly. If you have thoughts or suggestions about this video or future videos, please let me know. And the videos we do now are largely influenced by your feedback on previous videos, so I always appreciate hearing what you guys would like to see in future videos. One last thing, thank you guys for watching and take great photos.